name of that band that's all women?
Called Shake 'Em Up Jazz.
Shake 'Em Up Jazz Band, yeah.
Okay,
yeah, cool. It was a nice band, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. That's great.
Yeah.
Sound good, too.
Yeah. Yeah, people often, you know, often when we play for a student concert and things like that, a lot of people ask, oh, why aren't there any women in the band? Well, there aren't that many that really is now is getting a few, but it used to be nobody before.
Yeah.
The only one I used to see years ago would be women that played piano.
I was about to say, yeah.
Yeah, but no, it's not blowing instrument, nor bass or drums and things like that.
Yeah, yeah. I know.
Pianos were common even back in the 20s. You know, they had a lot of lady piano players.
You killed it?
Yeah, I kind of turned it off. I don't want someone to come in and turn on Big Freedom while you guys are playing.
Yeah, we should be starting.
So, will I be able to hear him talk?
Yeah, we'll open it up just a crack when he goes up there.
Because I think he's going to talk about Beras, and I don't want to repeat the same thing. All right.
Put your collar inside on the other one. One of them's good, one of them's hanging outside.
We used to have a trumpet player in the band that got to be 103 years old. Lionel Furbo. He was in the band for about 30 years. And he played up into his 90s with us.
Yeah.
And then I brought Jamil in for a second trumpet because he couldn't play the tricky parts.
Right.
But he still sang and he played some of it.
That's right, I remember.
Yeah, he was an amazing guy.
Yeah.
He started with us in 1970.
Wow.
And he stayed with us all that time.
Yeah. So you've been in the band since 1970.
Yeah, I started the band in 1967.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
A long time ago. let's see. I was 20.
He could have ironed his shirt.
22. Mm-hmm. When did you move to the States?
In 1965.
Okay, so you were 20 when you moved here. Yeah,
In 65 I was 20, yeah.
Okay, did you move straight to the States?
No, I was in Chicago for a bit, but not very long, only about 6 months.
Okay.
That's how I got my visa. I had a job in Chicago working for another record company.
Oh,
actually.
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go.
And now I'm back doing the same thing again.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Bookends,
I took a 50-year break and then I'm back in that business again. Yeah, I had met a guy in Europe that had a record company and a big record store up there. And I told him I was interested in coming to America. And he said, oh, yeah, you can work in my shop. And it was easy then. You know, there was no homeland security.
Right.
And the quota system was still in those days. So Europeans had a high quota, so it was easy to come in. So I got a green card within a couple of months.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, it was amazing. Then the law changed, actually, shortly after that.
Oh, did it?
Yeah, I think 65. Okay. I think it changed so that then there was more difficult then to get a permanent.
A permanent visa.
Yeah, permanent visa.
My boyfriend immigrated from Ukraine.
Oh, really?
Yes, but it was after the Soviet Union collapsed, and he and his family are Jewish, and at that time, there was a special immigration policy for Jews from the Soviet Union, and so they actually were able to qualify for the program and to immigrate over.
Oh, yeah. But Chris is from the Hungarian background.
Oh, okay, cool. Very cool, yeah.
He's also Jewish.
Yeah.
The rest of us, a lot. Quite a few of these people are not from New Orleans, actually, in this band.
Yeah.
They are newcomers to New Orleans.
That's great.
Yeah. But Peter is from New Orleans. He's from New Orleans family, the bass player. But the rest, and Jamil, the trumpet player.
He's from New Orleans.
Yeah. The rest of them are all from different places.
Yeah.
What? Dropping the cradle. I know it. There's 34 people that haven't shown it, but I think 6:05 we start.
They've got to get out of here.
Okay.
Seven. They've got a hard deadline, so we got to.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, they got other jobs.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them do, not all.
This audience likes to keep things.
We keep it on time.
On time?
Yes.
Yeah, so.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. she says Manuel Manetta was her great uncle.
Oh, really?
Yes, yes, and he taught her how to play piano.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Yeah, she's here tonight. Yeah.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
I hope I get my story right. Hello, hello? Is it working? Yeah, it is working. All right. I don't have to do such a big introduction now because Alfred took care of that. That was good. I just can tell you a little bit about my connection with Bill Russell. I met Bill when I arrived in New Orleans in 1965 at the Preservation Hall. So I was hanging out there listening to the jazz players. And Bill was the selling records and doing odd jobs there. And I was familiar with who he was because of his American music recordings, because I had played in a band in Sweden that based their style on these American music records. So I started talking with Bill about music in general, and I ended up helping him with some of his work, transcribing interviews and so on. And he was then working on his General Morton book. And then a few years later, I decided to form the Ragtime Orchestra. And Bill joined us on the violin, and he played with us for many years, about 25 or 30 years, long time. I gotta turn the page here. All right. And we played at the first jazz festival in New Orleans in 1970. And the following year, we went to the Newport Festival. And then we started doing tours in Europe and also in America. And to Bill Russell, I met Manuel Manetta, who was born in 1889 and died in 1969. Bill and I visited him in his studio in Algiers and also in the hospital shortly before he passed away. And the information that I will give you tonight will be based on his interviews and also some interviews with other musicians from that period. So we're going to focus on the period when Manetta was actually active playing in New Orleans as a musician. And he started in 1906. And he played music through the 1920s. After that, he concentrated on teaching music. He studied violin and trombone with Charles DeVerges, and he took piano lessons from a teacher called Laura Albert. And he also learned to play the guitar, mandolin, and string bass. He got a trumpet lesson from Manuel Perez, and clarinet lesson from Wade Whaley. Later on, he learned to play the saxophone. So he very early learned many different instruments. So his first professional musical engagement was in 1906 with cornet player Tom Albert. Manetta played violin in this group, and this was an all reading band, not a jazz band. And a bit later he joined trombone player Jack Carey's band, which was more of a ragtime and a jazz type of band. In the interviews, he mentions a lot of different tunes that he liked and played, and we're going to play some of them tonight. We're going to start the presentation by playing a tune called Moonwinks from 1904, which is a mazurka. And Manetta explained to Bill Russell the difference between a waltz and a mazurka. We're going to ask Chris to show us the difference between a waltz and a mazurka.
Waltz.
Waltz. There we go. Okay, now we're going to play this song for you. Very good. Get my guitar. All right. Everybody ready? Okay. Oops. Thank you. All right, so this was the kind of music you heard before we had any jazz. And next we're going to do a song that, I lost my place here. Oh yes, we're going to do a song that Manetta, he went to listen to Robichaud's orchestra, was playing at the Lincoln Park, and he heard George Bakir was a very famous clarinet player playing with Robichaud's orchestra, and he played this song, which is called Anita, subtitled Spanish Serenade. And Manetta really liked this song. He even recorded it himself many years later. So we're going to have a go at that one, Anita. All right. Whoops. You got the intro on that. Go ahead. Bam, bam, ba-bam. Back on. All right. Manetta is one of the few musicians interviewed that actually played with Buddy Bolden. So we should talk a little bit about Buddy Bolden. Buddy Bolden was born in 1897, and he is credited with being the first jazz man, and there is some evidence to back this up. Musicians and other people that heard him in person, they pretty much agree that he was the one that started it all, that is jazz music. So, when Manetta played violin with Bolden in 1906, the trombonist Frankie Dusen had taken over the leadership of the band. Bolden was already acting strange and showing signs of mental illness. Manetta talks about Bolden getting sick in the middle of a job and they had to take him off the stage. He was talking out of his head, Manetta said. So by September 1906, Bolden had completely stopped playing, and the following year, he was admitted to the East Louisiana State Hospital in Jackson, Louisiana, and he remained there till he passed away in 1931. So Manetta remembers playing Panama Rag with Bolden and Dusen. And this is a different song from one, the one that is now known as Panama Rag, which comes from a later period, from 1912, still played today. We're going to play the early Panama Rag from 1904. You will notice on this song that the clarinet plays a lot of the melody in the song. This was quite common in the early bands. All the bands had violin players in those days. And the clarinet and the violin often play the melody. So you will notice that today. And if they didn't have a violin, like in the famous photograph of Buddy Bolden, he has two clarinet players. One of them is playing a C clarinet, and he's actually, that's to read the violin parts. So we're gonna do Panama Rag. All right, find my way over here. Thank you. right, that was the Panama Rag. And another tune that is associated with Buddy Bolden is the Buddy Bolden Blues, and also known as I Thought I Heard Buddy Bolden Say, which comes to us from General Morton. The same theme is also part of a tune called St. Louis Tickle, written in 1904. We will play a little bit of St. Louis Tickle and then go into Buddy Bolden Blues. Nobody knows which of these songs came first. So here we go with St. Louis Tickle.
Thank you.
Manetta's ethnic background, as he says himself in the interview, is Italian, Spanish, and Creole. There were other musicians in his family. His brother Victor played cornet and bass drum, and he had two uncles, Deuce Manetta and Jules Manetta, who played trombone and cornet. And Manetta is also the uncle of pianist Dolly Adams. I remember her playing at Preservation Hall with Josh Lewis band in the 1960s. And her three sons became very well-known musicians in New Orleans, jazz and R&B music. Placide and Gerald Adams, both bass players, and Justin Adams, who played guitar on many Fats Domino records. Manetta himself was never really well known in jazz history. He decided early on in the 1920s instead to concentrate on teaching, and thereafter rarely played in public. However, his early career in music was very busy. Already as a teenager, he started playing solo piano in Storeville at the famous Lulu White place, Mahogany Hall, and he played there for about 2 years. And in those days, there were no nights off. You play 7 days a week and long hours. So 1 week, he decided to take a night off, and he hired a substitute piano player. Of course, this guy didn't show up. So Manetta lost his job at Lulu White's. But he moved on to another Storyville engagement, also playing solo piano at the place called the Brass Railing, where he stayed for about eight months. Then he moved on to working with a trio, with Peter Bocage on violin and Chris Miner on drums at the Cabaret, also in Storyville. This was another long engagement of about 2 years. And with Bocage, they sometimes played some light classical pieces, like The Poet and Peasant, an overture that was written in 1846 by an Austrian composer, Franz von Zuber. And this overture became a sort of a test piece for pianists to see if they were any good at reading music. And Gellerol speaks of being asked to read his piano score in St. Louis, and he managed to pass the test by playing it from memory. He kind of cheated a bit. So anyway, the guy that was testing him said afterwards, "Don't mess with this guy, he's a real shark." So we're now going to put Matt Rode and Chris Tokarski to the test, all playing Poet and Peasant. All right, guys. Thank you. recorded this piece also as a piano solo in the 1950s. And this piece was also used in a 1935 Popeye cartoon called The Spinach Overture. All right. And then Manetta moved on to working actually with a band, a small band at the Cadillac Cabaret, which was right next door to the Lyric Theater. And in the band was the future clarinet star Albert Nicholas, who credited Manetta with teaching him a lot about music. The next piece we're going to play is a tune called Old New Orleans Blues. Manetta wrote this violin and piano arrangement to show Bill Russell the early New Orleans blues style. And we're going to feature Matt Rohde again on the violin on this one, the Old New Orleans Blues. You got the intro on that. Yeah, I think I do. Yeah, it's a violin part.
You got it? And next we're going to move on to General Morton, who was a very important man in the early jazz. And he also, like Manetta, spent a lot of time playing solo piano in the bordellos. For some reason, he claimed to be older than he was. He added 5 years to his age. And he stated that he invented jazz in 1902, but he was only 12 years old then. That's a bit suspect. So actually, he was about the same age as Manuel Manetta, and he was born in 1890. In store, Morton was known as the winding boy. I'm not going to explain that to you. He was very popular with the prostitutes for singing a lot of obscene lyrics. You won't hear those tonight. He cleaned it up a little bit. But before we start that song, I want to read you an excerpt from an interview with one of the store old madams, Countess William Piazza. Needless to say, that wasn't her real name. I thought it was quite amusing. Anyway, she says that
I was reluctant at first because I thought it might lower the tone and the dignity I wish to maintain. So once I broke the ice, the others followed suit. The pianists, they work for tips. And as for making $100 a night, like John Morton claimed, I say it was most unlikely. My best girls didn't make that kind of money. Anyway, in those days, they didn't call it jazz, they called it ragtime. So now we'll now play our version of Mining Boy Blues with cleaned up lyrics, of course. And we featured Joe Goldberg on clarinet and vocals. Mining Boy Blues.
Thank you.
General Morton piece. We're going to ask Chris to play this piece for us. It's called The Spawning House Rag, also known as The Perfect Rag. We'll see.
We'll see.
Perfect. Yes. Thank you. Well, I think we just about run out of time, so we're not going to get to all the songs that we had on the list here, unfortunately. Sorry about that. There's a lot more to it than a story, but we didn't have time for all of it tonight. And I hope you learned a little bit about him. He never became a famous musician, but he had a great influence on the early jazz players by teaching them to read music. And he also gave lessons to many musicians that later became well-known jazz players, like Henry Red Allen, for example, and Freddie Coleman, local drummers. He took drum lessons from Manetta. Kind of interesting. He didn't even play drums, but he taught drums. Okay. And Bill Russell had an idea of writing a book about Manetta, and he interviewed him numerous times, starting in the 1950s. And these interviews are all here at the Historic Collection. And hopefully someday somebody will pick up on Bill's idea and finish this project. The interviews contain a huge amount of information about Dolan's position and all the places where they played. And it would make a really fascinating book. Anybody want to pick up on that? Well, it's about, I think, at least 50 interviews. So there's a lot to listen to. And so we don't really have to finish off, and we're going to do a song that was used in the band's early period for a goodbye song, and it's called Get Out of Here.
Thank you.
Here for putting this on. Thanks a lot. Good night.